Well, you know that face. Robert Bathurst is Sir Anthony on Downton Abbey. He's also starred in last year's The Edge of War, airing on Netflix. And he's performed 8 of Louise Penny's Inspector Gamache novels for Macmillan Audio. He's back as Inspector Gamache, this time the book A World of Curiosities. Thank you so much for talking with me.
Hello. Hi, Kim. Hi.
So, A World of Curiosities, just the name itself, is intriguing.
Mm. It is. And Louise Penny has struck again. I mean, this is, I think, her 18th novel in the Three Pines Gamache series. And she keeps on giving. It is the most fantastic and extraordinary body of work that she's built and developing these characters, the regular characters, and also the new ones who come in, and all the whodunits that are created in and around them. So yes, we're back in Three Pines. Sometimes every second book, I think she goes off. We go off to another part of Canada. In fact, we went to Paris not so long ago, a couple of years ago. But this, we're back in Three Pines, and we're shifting time. We're shifting time back to a time when, before, for those of you who can read the book, so where Gamache meets Jean-Paul for the first time, and it flashes forward and flashes back, and it's time slips of a sort, which I don't think we've had before in the ones that I've read. I've read the last 8 of her series. So it's a different construction, but also just as thrilling.
Yeah, and you know, people typically see you either acting on stage or in a film. How did you find Inspector Gamache's voice? Because it's a whole different beast, right?
He is. I imagine him, and I imagine I try to embody wisdom. I try to embody steely toughness with a heart. It's a very strange combination. It's the most brilliant creation that Louise has come up with, because he is really hard and embodies goodness. And I think goodness is a very difficult thing to get across in drama. I mean, everybody likes a villain. Everybody likes to play a villain.
Right.
But to play true goodness is a bit of a dance. And certainly in the writing, it's all there. And so I say, I just read it. I try and embody that as best I can.
Yeah, you know, and the thing too, when you're doing a film, you know, I've worked with voice for most of my life. So it's almost a restraint, right? It's different than, like you say, playing a villain. It's almost free reign, go crazy. But when you're being kind and good, there's more depth, I think, required.
Yes, and I think even if you're working in audio, you've got to sort of believe it behind the eyes, like you do on film in some ways. I think it sort of has to come, from deep, whatever it is you're playing. I mean, that's all process. I'm not quite sure if that's interesting to your listeners, but you have to find it. It can't just be in the voice. It has to erupt,
yeah.
I believe. So the process in a strange way is not dissimilar to what you do on film. Although it is the same acting impulse. It's a performative impulse, and you just have to find it and deliver the character as best you can. But it has to come from deep.
Yeah. So tell me about this story. What's going on in Three Pines?
Well, we start off in a frozen lake. She writes cold so well. I here in London at the moment, we are very cold. We think it's cold. We're freezing at -3. You know, and the country has stopped, but Canada is another thing entirely, and there's all around North America. You do cold properly.
I'm in Michigan. So, I'm in Michigan. I just bought another wool sweater.
I can believe it. Well, I spent some of my happiest times in Chicago, and so yes, I've done cold. She writes cold so well. So there we are. We've got this. Victim, but that is way back in the past, and of course the protagonists, who were children then, are then adults, and of course the suspicions arise from their lives, and also the connection that Gamache has had with them. It's extremely rich. It's extremely complicated, complex emotionally, and it puts Gamache once again in the most deepest peril, and I love the fact that she makes me think every time I read these books that come in, and I know nothing about them, and I'm reading them, and I think, oh, well, this is probably the last Gamache because he can't possibly survive this one.
She pulls another rabbit out of the hat.
She pulls it out of the hat. I mean, you know, superbly. I mean, magnificently. And I do a trick, actually, with the audio, the studio managers always, whenever I'm reading them. And I ask him or her at about halfway through and three quarters of the way. And right at the end, I say, who done it? Who done it? Tell me who done it. And they always get it wrong. So it shows how perfectly constructed her books are.
I think that's the draw. That's the draw. That's why she just somehow whips up these new scenarios. I read where they described it as a tale of forgiveness and redemption. How does that play into it?
Absolutely. And I think that is also key to the whole Three Pines series, is that whatever goes on, is vile, some of the stories and some of the things that happen and is true violence going on. But this is the point I made about goodness is there, because that's where the goodness lies is in a belief in redemption.
Yeah.
And whether we're spiritual or not, whether you can, you know, take it or leave it, whatever it is, there is that undercurrent in it, which I think is not just heartwarming. It's not just sentimental. I think it's properly emotional. I think there's a difference between sentiment and emotion.
Yeah.
And I think this carries an emotional weight, which goes way beyond sentiment.
Yeah. And you get to kind of explore some new areas, at least vocally, right? Because doesn't in this episode, this book, it feels like an episode in this book, does Inspector Gamache kind of face his own fears in a way as well?
Yes. I mean, he is enjoyably introspective, realizes how lucky he is in his relationships and realizes the damage. The thing about these characters, they're all damaged. They're all lost.
Right.
And Louise is very, she loves the whole Three Pines thing, is that everyone's flailing. And of course, in life, no one's perfect. I did hear somebody say something about that they reckon they were perfect and said something along those lines. And I just think, who are you kidding? And Gamache does not kid himself. He's not self-indulgent in any way, but he learns throughout the books, and 18 books later, Gamache is his wisdom is redoubled, because everything he experiences, he banks and he learns from, and we learn wisdom along with him.
It's got to be so much fun. I mean, we're talking eight books that you've narrated. Were there any challenges along the way? Like, that you face when how do you get prepared for the character when you're getting ready to voice it?
Well, the main job of an audiobook reader, I believe, is not to be annoying. That's the first step.
It's true.
It's because you're getting you are in between the author and the audience. The author and the audience in the book form, they're reading.
Yeah.
They engage their own imagination. This is my take on Louise's words, which I have to invite the listener to surrender to, and to accept, to sort of to come along the ride with the reader. The challenge is, first of all, to find something that's plausible and will swing along and won't jar. But then, yes, of course, you find the characters, and there's a lot of voices in there. There's a variation of the characters. I don't want people to think that there are 40 different actors reading it. Of course, it's only one reader, but you try to find the essence of whoever it is who's speaking at that moment, and give as much investment into the preparation of it with the small characters as you try to do for the major ones. There are a few, like the regulars, I can bring off the shelf now and do them. But of course, the new ones need preparation. And the big step in the one I did in France was to make every character sound like Inspector Clouseau.
Yeah. I mean, it seems really complex to me. Is there anything that you do to prepare, like either mentally? How many times do you read through? Do you make notes? I'm just curious about that whole process.
Well, the process that I employ is to read it first without even thinking about reading it out loud. It's just to absorb the book as a reader. And then on the second and third reads, I get more detailed into that. I try to map out the construction of the book, and then go into and find the major characters and find their balance and where they are and where they're pitched, just simply technically, which which is informed by what I know about them through having read the book. So I don't make any presumption when reading it what the character will sound like. And then, yes, I do work on it, and I just do it as best I can. I mean, at the moment, I'm playing in Scrooge in the Christmas Dolly Parton's Christmas Carol here in London, and so I'm playing Tennessee, and so in the same process, I'm playing an accent, and you have to find it and reach it and land it.
It seems, yeah, being an actor, I just couldn't do it. Do you work at a specific time of day, and do you work for a specific amount of hours? How do you keep your voice good?
Well, the voice isn't in terms of it's the organ of the voice is not in peril because the voice comes from elsewhere, so you're not it's passing through the larynx rather than being forced by them. In terms of energy, the key to that is the director. And I really want to give a shout out to Lorelei King, a very fine voice artist in her own right, American actor and director. And we work from 12 till 6 in a studio, and we get our breaks and we take our time. We have 6 days. It's not one of those ones where I just charge at it. We work at it, and when I get to certain characters, we discuss it. It's proper direction, which I think is, I don't know how rare that is in audiobooks. The audiobooks I've done haven't always been like that. And so I think the richness of the Gamache series and the success that the Gamache series has had is shared and very much down to Lorelei King.
Yeah. What do you think it is about her? Like Louise Penny, her books, what is it that connect so closely with the reader? I mean, they're all in.
They are all in, and they are. She's very attentive to how things might be received, and she's wonderfully honest about her first drafts. I mean, and I've met her and I've interviewed her actually for one of the Glass Houses at the end of Glass Houses. She came into the studio. She won't have listened to any of them, I'm absolutely sure, because all the voices are in her head. Thank you very much. She doesn't want somebody else getting in the way. But she's immensely supportive of the audiobooks, what they've been doing. And if there's ever been any sort of success with it, she's always acknowledging that, which is great. But she says her first drafts. She's very frank about it. And she splurges it out, she says. And then the work starts in a sense. She really gets crafting, and she's a master craftsman, and has I think the audience in mind the whole time. Well, primarily, she has her characters in mind, and that all erupts. But she knows that she's got to land it with a critical public, and so she's very, very rigorous with it.
You know, I was reading through reviews and I was reading like critics and they're saying that like Three Pines is kind of like a character in itself. You've read all through these. Would you describe Three Pines as a character?
Well, Three Pines has a sort of mystical quality to it, which is instantly appealing. It's not quite Brigadoon. It's not quite Shangri-La. But there is this sort of oddness to it. This place that is not on the map, this place where flawed individuals find themselves collecting and finding comfort, and so that in itself has a strangeness to it. So it's like everywhere and nowhere, and one can find one's sanctuary, if you like, anywhere in the world. And her Three Pines is a place of sanctuary, and so it is a place where. Well, it's not only a place where a lot of murders happen. It's a place. It's a place where people find contentment to one degree, and understand something about the mysteries of life.
Yeah, we were watching Columbo last night, and it's it's like wherever this guy goes, someone's dying. You know, it's
yeah, you don't want to.
It's just the way it works, right? What was that?
Exactly. You don't want to hang around next to Peter Falk, I tell you, and then you'll be. In peril, but it is of course, and it is a construct, Three Pines, but absolutely it is spiritually definitely a character.
Do you voice other books?
I've just done a rather good one for Penguin about night walking, about somebody who walks at night, and the and those, it's linked with poems. I like reading verse and or reading out, reading and performing verse. And so, and that's one on that night walking. I've got one about Goodbye, Mr. Chips is one I've just done recently, which is a quite short classic English tale about a fading schoolmaster. So yes, I mean, I do other ones as well, but this is for the North American market. Unfortunately, my efforts for the Louise Penny aren't available in my country. it's another publishing deal, but worldwide in North America, Macmillan Audio have this one.
I know I've got you only for a couple of minutes, but what's next? What are you up to next?
Well, here I am in the dressing room of the Queen Elizabeth Hall in London on the South Bank. And I'm doing Dolly Parton's Smoky Mountain Christmas Carol, where it's a musical. I've been in the business 40 years, and this is my first musical. Thank you very much. Scrooge has a redemption song at the end, and I am on stage with all these brilliant and very, very, very talented musical theatre artists and a band, and Dolly has insisted that it's she's transplanted the Victorian London to the Appalachian Mountains in 1936, depression was still raging, and here we are with an Appalachian string band music, and it's packing them in, and there's loads of people wearing Dolly Parton hats out there in the audience.
Ivan, as you described it, I mean, I'd love to see something like that in London, you know.
It's going a storm. It's great.
Curiosities. Where can people get it and download it, and where can listeners and viewers connect with you?
With me. Sorry, I didn't quite pick up that last bit. The voice went slightly. I'm so sorry.
Yeah. First of all, where can we hear the book? Where can we download it? And then also tell me about you. Where can we connect with you?
Well, I'm not very prolific on social media, but I do have, you can see my biog on IMDb and I think Wikipedia and so forth. And I'm on Twitter at Robert Bathurst. The book, most importantly, is going to be on Audible and all other fine platforms for audiobooks.
Perfect. I can't wait to talk to you again, Robert. Have a great one, and thank you so much.
Lovely to talk to you. Thank you.